Hello and welcome to Rude Musicians Don't Starve. I'm your host, Michael Elsner, and today I'm with my good friend, David Browning, and this is going to be a fantastic conversation. David has a long history in the music industry. He spent a number of years working with Katy Perry. He's spent a number of years working with Diane Warren, who's, you know, massive hit songwriter. Spent a long time working behind the scenes, doing a lot of programming for some very big Sony artists, and maybe you can chat about that a little later. And he's also spent time out on the road touring really the world with a lot of CCM artists, including Avalon and Natalie Grant and many others. So he's had a long track record. David and I actually go back many years through a mutual friend, because you were roommates at one time a long time ago with a good buddy of ours named Bryce.
That's right. That's exactly right. Yes. I love it.
I think I even probably met you back in, you know, 2002 or something. I just don't really recall.
I know. It's so crazy. Yeah. Funny Everything how, leads back to Bryce. Yes.
A lot of things do.
That's
so,
right.
Dave, thanks for coming and hanging out with us today. Speaking of actually, like, you know, we're going back in time with knowing Bryce for so long, that goes back to the early 2000s. So, you know, you've been in the industry a solid, you know, almost two decades, actually probably more.
Yeah, I've been in town here since 1995. So we're looking at 25 years now. Yeah.
Wow. That's a long track record.
That's a long haul.
Yeah. Well, that's fantastic, because, you know, the goal here is really to have a long-term career as a musician. Right. You know, so you're the walking definition of it. But when it comes to that specifically, what would you say is, as a musician who's had a 25-year-long career as a full-time musician, what would you say is your definition of success, and how does that look to you?
Sure. Yeah, I know for me, success, the definition for me was, you know, I grew up having a dream, and it was to be able to do music full time, to be able to travel some around the world, get paid doing so, not have to spend my dollars on hotel rooms and flights and things like that. And let me quickly say, I'm definitely not the most talented guy in town. There are guys who can play circles around me, write circles around me, produce circles around me. But I have, I think success, if you're easy to work with, and you do have some talent, and you continue to work hard, and people enjoy and want to work with you, you find yourself in situations that are very comforting to them, or they feel right at home. Oftentimes when I'm working in the studio, they're like, gosh, there's no stress. This is amazing. My last experience wasn't this way. I think those things kind of bring about the success factor. People will want to seek you out, will want to work with you when you're easy to work with, you're talented, maybe not the most talented, but you're talented and you work hard, you show up on time. When you do those things, that will yield what I found success for me, which is working continually, getting paid for what I do, not having to go, you know, throw papers in the morning as a second job or deliver pizzas at night as a second job. You know, there's definitely been lean times, but I've been able to continue for the 25 years of living here, and having that definition of success for myself, which is kind of standing on my own two feet, working hard, being able to continue to do music in whatever way, shape, or form it is. And you know, a musician's life is constantly being redefined, especially in these days. And as long as you can move with it, redefine yourself, go with the flow, make yourself valuable and relevant in whatever environment you find yourself in, you will be successful.
You know, it's funny, you're talking about how things change. And as you said that, I just thought, you know, I did my first album back in 1996 on old Tascam DA-88.
Yeah, DA-88s, baby. Right? That's right.
And they were the equivalent of the old ADATs.
That's
and
right.
You just think of how much just the recording process has changed in the last 25 years.
It is. I will never forget a session I had. I was one of the first guys in town to have some sort of small Pro Tools rig. It was called Pro Tools Project. I had it in the spring of 1996. It wasn't until about the end of 97, 98 before people were investing in Pro Tools rigs. And I remember having a very famous session bass player come over to my house And he looked at what my setup was and he immediately left. He was like, well, you don't have ADATs here. And what's this hard disk recording thing? I don't feel comfortable with this. He packed up and left. And yet a year later, here it is. It's very comfortable and easygoing and everybody's all about it. And I'm like, dude, I was doing this a year ago. What's the deal? You know? So
you were, part of your strategy then was that you were like, you know, staying ahead of the curve.
Very much so. Yeah. And even when, you know, I was probably one of the first guys that probably sold off a ton of my keyboards and went more with the BST route and, plugins and stuff like that, even when they didn't sound great, knowing that if I can learn this now when they're not great, when they do finally sound better, I'm already ahead of the game. I know how to get around. It's not like I'm playing catch up. And I really think that is something we always have to do to be successful, is finding kind of what the next big thing is. You know, all of a sudden right now, TikTok is huge, but the people who were on board a year ago, year and a half ago, 2 years ago, when it was just starting out, they're like, oh yeah, that's all old hat. They're already looking for the next one. And I kind of took that approach to equipment, software, things like that, knowing that it was going to head more that way.
Right. So basically, by staying ahead of the curve, you know, that's ultimately what allowed you to get a lot of the gigs that you ultimately got.
Absolutely. Yeah. You become the relevant guy when it's like, hey, here's the new way of doing it. And you're already a year in or 2 years in and know your stuff. Everybody else is trying to play catch up and you're already that far ahead. People call you quickly, either with how do I do this? Or, hey, can I hire you to do this?
Right. I think that's a great example of you know, there's two musicians, there's two types, right? You have the types of musicians who look at it like a business, they treat it like a business, mm-hmm. and they ultimately make entrepreneur income as a result.
Right.
They stay consistent, they're getting, you know, constant work. And as you said, I feel the same way about myself. I'm definitely right. not the best musician at all. Right. But I remember even thinking, you know, years ago when I was, you know, living out in Los Angeles and I was driving to these sessions and I was, you know, driving down to, you know, like a you know, one of the bigger studios where there was a, you know, orchestra, you know, and I'm going to be playing mandolin today. I'm playing mandolin with an orchestra. What the heck am I doing? And thinking, how did I get here? You know, I'm not a mandolin player, but I have a mandolin.
Right.
And I know where the notes are on it. But
that's right.
A lot of it comes down to you don't have to be the best. You really just have to treat it like a business. So
that's right.
It's those who treat it like a business. You know, they have that business income. But a lot of musicians, they treat it like a hobby.
Right. And you bring up a very good point. I have to often catch myself in that way as well. For all the folks who are like, you know what, music is great and it's art and I don't need to charge for it and all that. And I'm like, you're okay, but you're kind of killing yourself here, and don't be mad if you're not making money on it years down the road and, you know, you're frustrated with your music career and not going anywhere. You really have to be a go-getter in this industry. You know, it's I look at every other industry. All of those people work for a living, be it a teacher, be it a hedge fund manager, be it a doctor, whatever it is, they are all not going to go to work, even though they love their patients or their students or their people that they're doing their hedge funds with, but they're not going to go to work and do it for free. Nor should we as musicians and creatives. And I think that's where the gray area has fallen, is everybody is like, well, I'm still going to do music even if I don't get paid. Well, that's great then. Just call it a hobby. That's fine. Don't call yourself a professional if you're not going to value yourself in the process of making music.
That's kind of almost like thinking like, well, my neighbor went to medical school, you know, but never became a doctor.
Right.
Yeah, I'm going to go over to them and have them, you know, treat me for medical problems.
That's right.
They're not a professional, right?
That's right. And you really have to walk into the mindset. Listen, there's nothing wrong with doing deals with friends or saying, hey, let me swap out. I'll play a part on yours and you can play a part on mine down the road. That's great. But you have to establish value for yourself or nobody else will. If you don't believe in yourself and you don't put a monetary value on you or show worth to others, even in the way you convey yourself, body language, the whole nine yards, people will not take you seriously and you will never make a dime. So you really just have to take that approach of, hey, I don't have to be a jerk about this, but hey, I do need to get paid for my time.
Yeah. And the value that you're bringing to the situation.
That's right. That's right.
You know, whether you're a performer, if you're performing live, you're bringing value. Not only are you bringing value to the venue,
yes,
by getting people in through the doors, you know, and having them stick around so they buy, you know, drinks and food or whatever else.
Right.
But you're also providing a service to the actual attendees, you know,
because
you're providing the service of entertainment.
That's right. That's exactly right. It's that simple.
Yeah. That's awesome. So on the flip side of that, you also said, your very first answer was, you know, during times of struggle or during hardships and stuff like that, you know, because every musician's life is not, it's not just a straight line to
right.
the top.
Yeah, right? That's right.
There's lots of ups and downs along the way. So what are some of the strategies that you've put to use, maybe even mindset strategies or whatever that you've implemented in your career when you've, you know, when things have gone down, maybe when, you know, you face the rejection. I mean, we all face rejection, but you know, maybe during the down times or times where there's not a lot of work coming in during a certain season or whatever. What are the different strategies that you've implemented to overcome those?
That's a fantastic question. And I you know, it's very interesting. I have, and I'm not using this to blow smoke at you. I've looked at your career as well. And it's been fun because I look to others and see, let me back up. I always enjoy learning, whether it's reading books about various things, whatever it is. I am constantly learning. I'm 51. I don't know it all. There's kids half my age and now even less than half my age who are doing amazing things. So I'm always studying on what everybody else is doing, you know, whether it's production tricks, whether it's writing, whether it's lyric lines and internal rhyming methods and figuring out their method to the madness, so to speak. So in down times, I'm not letting myself sit on the couch and watch, you know, binge a Netflix show or something like that. I'm trying to figure out new ways, learn new gear, learn new strategies of how to market myself through social media. I'm not doing that well yet, but I will at some point, you know. It's always bettering myself so that I continue to have perceived value. And that can be difficult. It's easy when you have a couple days off. I borderline on being either a workaholic or completely lazy. It's hard to find that middle ground for me.
Yeah.
But I have to put one foot in front of the other. And even if my path is not a straight line, at least I'm moving. And so that's always the approach I'm taking, is I've got to keep continuing to get better. You cannot rest on your laurels. That was probably my biggest mistake growing up. And I know one of our questions coming up is, what would you go back and tell your 20-year-old self?
Oh, yeah,
I'll just jump to that. Forgive
me.
Is not to rest on your successes. And the reason why is, great, you may be making great money now and you may be successful now, but the music industry is very much like Baskin Robbins in that you're the flavor of the month. And very quickly, you may find that somebody else or several other people become the flavor of the month. And all of a sudden, all you're doing at that point is just riding out your royalties and you're not really building anything else. So when you have those successes, you better just start pushing and capitalizing and working even harder the moment you have those successes. You have to solidify your space. You know, I look at like a producer artist named Zed right now. The one thing I've appreciated about him, he'll have a number one hit, and before that number one is done, he's already got two or three other tunes already out. The guy is just not resting. He can rest when he's in his mid-30s, 40s, whatever, and go move to Greece or wherever he wants to live. But he realizes at this moment, I got to be pounding. I cannot let up. I got to put the foot on the gas and just keep it there. And that's huge.
You know, that's awesome. Thank you for sharing that. You know, I think that when people look at successful musicians, you know, and they see, oh, they just did this, and you know, how come they don't take a break? How come they don't stop? How come they don't just rest? And for me, it's always been, you know, I can't stop.
Right.
Because music is just, it's like breathing, right?
It is.
Like you just took a big breath. Why doesn't he stop and not breathe for a while?
Right.
How can you do that? It's something that you're so passionate about, and it's fun.
Absolutely.
I think the thing is that there's like this hump, right? When you cross over this certain hump, it suddenly becomes a lot of fun because the struggle, you're no longer in that struggling phase anymore.
Right, right.
Right. And now you can start connecting with a lot of other people. You can start, networking, but you can start co-writing, collaborating. And that becomes a lot of fun on a creative side, especially as you open up more and more and more doors, you know, but the big thing is to overcome this hump. If you're always staying at the bottom of that hump where it's a struggle and you're starving and you're not making any money and you can't get past it, I can how you just look like, oh man, I just want to take a break. But when you cross over that, it's taking a break. It's almost like when I go on vacation, I can't wait to get back. So I can't wait to get back to my studio and pick up a guitar and start creating. Cause no matter where I'm at, I'm like, I just need to do something.
That's right. That's right.
You know,
that is exactly right.
So we've talked about, you know, your skill set and how, you know, you've constantly worked at developing your skill set, you know, even during the downtimes, how you've really actively taught yourself stuff and you've been an active learner. And then also, you know, these are also purposeful actions that you've taken, you know, to get to this point. But, you know, when it comes to like the mindset, you know, when it comes to those downtimes or even before you maybe even crossed over that hump, maybe you see this with some of the artists that you work with, what would be your advice or your perspective of having the right mindset? How to have the right mindset, how to stay in the right mindset, you know, even when the struggle is very real and it doesn't seem like you're getting ahead, what would be some tactics or strategies that you would suggest to someone who, if they came to you, said, you know, I'm just struggling. I can't get past this hurdle. This is the one hurdle in my music career. I just can't get past. I just want to give up and walk away. What would you
recommend? Yeah. That's a fantastic question. I think for me personally, if it's just me in the room and it's just me and my thoughts, I realize I have to put one foot in front of the other and I kind of have to block out the noise. I can't let the naysayers dictate my direction or my drive. You know, the moment that I allow somebody else to say, oh, you can't do that, or you know what, you're not going to be able to do that. It's interesting. I grew up as a farm kid in middle America, and we were not near any big city. And I remember hearing friends and relatives and other friends' parents be like, oh, music's going to be a cool hobby, and I hope you can teach someday. But the idea of ever becoming a professional musician, oh, well, yeah, other people will get to do that. And that's fine, but don't ever count on that because that's really hard. And you just have to put it aside and be like, no, that's exactly where I'm going to end up. And you just have to kind of block out the noise. And if you have to utterly believe in yourself more, as many as 10 people would, you know, you really have to go in it hard and heavy. It's life or death. It's do or die. Burn the bridge behind you so that you only have one way to go. And that's kind of what's pushed me through. Other than that, I found other friends who had similar struggles. We, you know, as I moved to town, I found the friends who had moved to town kind of around the same time, maybe a year before, maybe a year after, but we were all at similar places in our careers. So if somebody is having a hard time, there's two or three of us surrounding them saying, no, you can do it. You can do it. Get there. And when I'm having a bad day, they're doing it for me. So I would say find friends who are either in similar positions, but you all can be cheerleaders for one another, because you're going to have days when you're just man, I want to give up. You know, it's hard. It's, you know, I think this is the worst industry, in that you'll hear no 1,000 times before you hear a yes. Yeah. And if you don't have thick skin or somebody to hold you up, you're going to get beat down by, like, you know, no number 50. So that's huge. From there, I think mentorships or being an apprentice to somebody is always huge, not only to learn and to grow from them, but also they will at some point introduce you to the right people. And that will also help your successful career.
You are 100% right. You're 100% right about that. You know, you find the right people to surround yourself with, you will ultimately end up meeting all the right people you ever to meet in your life that will help sustain your career. But it starts by having an intentional community.
Very much so. And building
intentional relationships, not just falling into relationships, but being very intentional on, I'm going to find this type of community of people, just like-minded musicians who are driven to succeed, and that's going to be my community.
That's right. Yeah. It's funny, as a programmer producer, I kind of came up being almost a lone ranger. Hey, I can program all the drums and the bass and everything else. And I didn't realize that was almost becoming a detrimental attitude to me, because all of a sudden I'm not hiring these people. I'm not allowing these players to make me better. Yeah. I'm just kind of resting on my own laurels. And it took me a long time, much longer than it should have, to realize, wait, I not only need these people to drive me and make me better, I need their community. I need their friendships as well. So I agree with you wholeheartedly that having that camaraderie and those folks who push you, they're only going to make you better, which ultimately gets you to your goal quicker.
Oh, yeah. And I see that even with like mastermind groups and stuff like that. You know, people will pay a lot of money to be in some different mastermind groups just for the community aspect of it.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. There's so much value in that. You know, we're always learning from one another. Even if somebody isn't up to your level, there's always a nugget or an experience or some way that you can experience walking in their shoes where it's like, oh, I can take that and apply that. That's good. So I'm right there with you.
And another thing that's also interesting is, you know, you also don't know where that person you met, who might be one or two or three rungs, you know, below you on the ladder at that moment, you don't know where they're going to be in a year.
I've met people
who, you know, I thought, well, they're just another independent musician, just another guy doing their thing, who ended up just having astronomical careers within a year and a half. I mean, just skyrocketing.
That's right. So let me give you the perfect example. And this is a lesson learned, and it still hurts to this day. And I laugh about it, but it's so valuable. I used to have a kid when I lived in Franklin, Tennessee, in a little duplex, and he lived literally two blocks over, and he'd come over, and his name was Ryan. And he'd be like, oh my gosh, dude, we got to write sometime. And I'm like, oh, dude, man, I'm busy. I got to go to New York and work with Rick Wake on, you know, behind the scenes sort of Celine thing and all that. And then I'm off to LA to work with, you know, Diane Warren. And, you know, for a couple years, he'd be like, dude, we got to work together. And finally, I guess he just left town. I lost track. I didn't pay attention to him. But about 5 years later, I heard an album I loved. And I was like, man, this is killer. So, of course, I bought the record, opened up the liner notes. And all of a sudden, I see this name over and over, Ryan Tedder, writing all these songs. So I was like, wait a second. And sure enough, I went to the internet and Googled a photo. And I was like, oh, boy. So this was back in the day of MySpace. So I've quickly found his profile and millions of followers and all this. And I wrote him. I was like, don't know if you remember me or not, but I just wanted to say congratulations on your success. And I've not heard a word from him since. So always take everybody seriously. You just absolutely never know. Much to what you said, never, ever, ever, you know, just discredit somebody based on either your inconvenience or you feeling like you're more important in any way.
Yeah, I have a friend of mine who you probably know. I'm not going to mention their name right now, but they had a great career for a while, and their star was shooting for a while, and she got a letter or an email from this little 14-year-old girl years ago. I still remember this conversation at a Starbucks out in California, and she got an email from this little girl who said she was a big fan and asked her if she could write with her sometime, and she ignored it and just kind of blew it off. And a couple years later, that little 14-year-old girl was Taylor Swift.
I
just always have to laugh. But, you know, here's the thing. This is a great example. And then we're going to wrap up with this. And I'd love to have you share with everyone what you're doing with crowd music. But this is actually a fantastic example. Ryan's had a fantastic career in the licensing world as well, as you know, right? But, you know, here's a guy who is very active in going out and trying to make opportunities. Now, if he was asking you to write with him, he was also asking a lot of other people to write with him.
Absolutely.
And actually, if you actually, his story is interesting. I know a bit about his story on how he actually got the ball rolling. And if you're listening, you can Google it. It's a fascinating story. But he basically just sent out an email and kind of worked out a way into an interview. And I mean, he was aggressive in how he got it.
Very much so.
But it is the same thing with Taylor. Here's this 13-year-old girl, you know, reaching out to this other girl who was having quite a bit of success at the time. And she just was reaching out to her. Hey, this is who I am. I know I'm just some unknown person, you know, from Pennsylvania or whatever, right? But she wanted to write with her. She was actively going out and finding the opportunities. And these are people who were in their teens at that time who became very successful. And so it's so important to actually take that action. You know, you will hear no's. These people heard no's from David and the other mutual person that we know. But you know what? They became massive stars because if you keep asking, if you keep pounding on doors, a door will open.
They will. They will indeed. Absolutely. Without a shadow of doubt. It's so funny you mentioned that, and forgive me for taking up all the time. Back in when I was in college days, I very much had that mindset, and we didn't have email back then. It was strictly telephone. And I would literally hunt down through the yellow pages or through information, you know, when you would dial up 411 or whatever it was, and get phone numbers of my favorite stars or people of influence, you know, and I would try calling them. And sometimes their gatekeeper would not let me through. And other times the person would directly answer the call. And I would just be like, hey, I'm a college kid in Missouri here. And I'm just really intrigued by this and curious of this and really love what you do here. And 9 times out of 10, they were just so overwhelmed that, first of all, you would cold call them and, you know, kind of fluff them up a little bit, that they would actually spend a decent amount of time visiting about what you want to do and all that. So very much what you're saying, don't be afraid to be aggressive and to reach out to folks. The worst thing they're going to do is ignore you or tell you no and you know, buzz off, you know. But more often than not, people will say, hey, I'm busy right now, let's schedule a time, or hey, yeah, let me answer your question, thanks for reaching out, you know. So I'm a big proponent of cold calls, reaching out, be kind in the process. I know that you're a big proponent of that as far as just going for the jugular, go for the highest person on the totem pole, or you don't need to work up, just go for it.
Yeah. You have nothing to lose. When I first moved to Los Angeles, you know, I as you know, I had a, you know, pretty 4.5 year career in Nashville. I was producing a bunch of records at the time and, you know, trying to get a publishing deal. I was trying to, you know, get the ball rolling. But I went out to Los Angeles and I really wanted to get a road gig at that time. I was like, I'm just moving to Nashville. I don't know anyone. What's the first thing I can do? Well, I'm a guitar player. I could definitely get a gig playing. I remember I Googled a bunch of people, and at that time, this is 2003, I was looking at all the pop artists. And, you know, pop artists at the time, one of them was really big, was Jessica Simpson. And I found her guitar player, and I found his website, and I emailed him. And I remember, you know, he emailed me right back and I asked him if we could go out and have lunch and whatnot. And I remember I met with him out at a restaurant in Burbank, California. And he's still a great friend of mine to this day now. But that was my first meeting with him. And so, you know, as we're talking, he goes, so who gave you my number? And or he gave me my email. And this is at the end of the lunch. And I said, oh, no. And I just found your website. And he kind of sat back, and I remember his eyes got kind of wet. He goes, you just reached out to me out of the blue? And I was like, yeah. And he just started laughing. He starts laughing. He's like, who does that? And I'm like, me.
That's right. You know? Well, that's right.
What else can I do? I mean, what am I going to do? Right. Wait 3 years until I meet someone who knows
Exactly. That's a whole thing. You know, the one thing I'm learning is we have X amount of time in our lives, you know, and it's like, you better make every minute count, you know, don't waste it away.
Yeah. That's, you know, that's what I talk about with the really through Real Musicians Don't Starve is, you know, the three keys to success. You have your skill set, you know, you have your mindset, and then you have your actions.
Right.
All three of them have to be in place.
That's right.
Today you covered all
that
three.
That is excellent.
But maybe you can share with us quickly a little about what you're doing with crowd music, because I think this crowd music is phenomenal.
Sure.
I'm a member of crowd music myself, but you can share a little bit with us.
Absolutely. So, you know, as a fellow musician, songwriter, producer, you know, we have seen basically the music industry continue to be redefined, and not necessarily in great ways or pro artist, pro creative ways. And so crowd music is actually a company that my business partner, Mike Castronovo, and I started. And basically, the sim- The simple answer is it allows creatives to make fantastic money again in music the way we did 20, 25, 30 years ago. And in the process, instead of paying marketing firms to make all these great songs and artists famous around the world, we're actually paying the fans good money as they talk about certain artists and songs on social media or send email links or whatever it is. So it allows artists and fans to work together to make successful songs, successful artists. And we report to SoundScan. The best way to think of us is the movie theater of the music industry. Release a song with us exclusively for a limited amount of time. Let it play out. Give your fans a choice. If I love this song so much, am I willing to part with a dollar now, not knowing how long it's going to be before you put it on streaming? And 99 times out of 100, if it's a song that resonates with somebody's heart, they're going to pay a dollar. They don't mind paying a dollar. In the process of doing so, each of those people who purchase your music become a part of your crowd. So it's much like getting email addresses in the days of old at shows and stuff like that. So the cool thing is, let's say you're an artist. Michael is an artist. He's in between releases. He's not going to put anything out for 6 months. So he has no income coming in. In our system, as each of those people in his crowd go out and purchase other music on Crowd Music, be it R&B, hip hop, classical, new age, jazz, polka, whatever it is, Michael is going to get a referral fee off of each of those sales. So now he's putting money in his pocket monthly that he never would have had a chance to make money on otherwise. So all of those projects that are on Crowd Music, everybody is kind of sharing in the wealth of all of those. So it's a rising tide raising all ships. And we find that all of our creatives are putting more money in their pockets than they have in a long time. So it's something where we're all working together. Great music, great opportunities to prosper together, and everybody ends up winning.
You've also been doing live concerts, right, through Crowd?
We have. It's funny. We built a live, well, the live streaming platform that we have in place has been in the works for 7 years. It was built with high definition audio and video from the start. It's not like a lot of the social media live streaming aspects where it's in mono, where it's grainy, where it's dropping frames, where it's meant for conversation and dialogue like this. Ours was built, it's stereo. You can throw it on your sound system at home. It sounds phenomenal. We've had people say several things like, I felt like I was watching a DVD. Some said, I felt like I was there. Technology doesn't get in the way. And it was built to coincide with great shows. Again, let's say you're playing Red Rocks in Colorado. Great, we sell out 18, 19,000 tickets, but there might be another 100,000 people worldwide who would pay 10, 15, 20 bucks to watch you perform there. So now you're making exponential income based, outside of the walls of that venue. And that's what it was originally built for. But with COVID and that coming along and tours canceling, all of a sudden that propelled our live streaming platform immediately to the top. So we're getting massive endorsements from like folks like IK Multimedia that say it's the best platform they've ever seen. We have a lot of summer festivals that are going to be using our platform. We have country artists like Thompson Square, Brian White. We have Justin Schultz this weekend, who's this 12-year-old jazz piano prodigy who's doing a masterclass. We have all sorts of artists coming aboard, sound stages across the country who are wanting to stage live rock concerts and use our platform. There's some pretty cool stuff going down.
It's the future of live music, in a sense, that's actually creating value. And I think one of the things... we talked a little bit earlier off camera and off record about it, but I'll throw it on the record now. I think one of the biggest mistakes that a lot of artists are doing, well-known artists, I'm not talking about independent artists who are just trying to build their fan base. I'm talking about well-known artists, especially during the COVID quarantine. I think one of the worst things that they're doing and that their record label is allowing them to do is do free shows from their house.
Totally agree.
I think what you're doing is that is the beginning of Napster for the live music market.
It is. So if we look at the traditional marketplace as it stands right now, basically everybody has thrown out the idea that recorded music no longer has value. That is your calling card. Put it on streaming services. That's what gets you known. And then you make your money at live shows. Well, great. Live shows are now gone. So now, much as you said, as those artists at whatever level feel like, hey, I need to give this to my fans. It's hard times. Or, oh, wouldn't this be cool if I did this? Well, what you don't realize is you, like you said, you are devaluing your live performance existence as you know it. So a year from now, people will be like, well, why would I ever pay to go, you know, pay more than X amount to go see a show? Or why would I pay to watch one online? And that's our thing. All of our events are ticketed. We also have tip jars, donation jars. I can tell you this, all the folks who are coming over and are paying for tickets, we're getting lots of tickets sold per artist. Not only that, we're seeing many, many hundreds of dollars being tipped per show, and the artists are walking away like, can I do another one of these tomorrow? This is the most I've made. You know, I did 10 Facebook Lives and I made more in an hour's time here than I have on all those others with tip jars and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. People who pay and have a paywall there and a threshold to go over, they want to be there and they're not afraid to spend money on their favorite artist. End of story. We've got the proof of that.
Yeah. And the truth is that people are not afraid to spend money. I think that's the biggest mindset that musicians have to have is that,
right.
You know, people are not afraid to spend money.
That's right. That's right.
There's stuff that they want and stuff that entertains them. Look, you know, you go to a movie theater now, it's like $17 or $18 for a
That's
movie.
Right. Yeah. Right?
But how often do you go to a movie? I mean, I love going to the movie theater. I love taking, you know, my fiance to the movies, and you know, yep. We make a whole event of it, and we go rather often. And it does cost a lot of money, but it's fun and it's enjoyable and we enjoy it. And yeah, that's why we work throughout the week to do the stuff
that we enjoy. That's right. That's exactly right. You know, there is this mentality of, you know, when something is free. Let's say you're playing a Facebook Live thing and it's free. I may not attend. I may come in and out and all that, and I don't think much of it. If I have to pay for something, all of a sudden, I desperately want to be there. I don't want to miss it. I want to engage more deeply. And so I think by artists doing that, being smart, you don't have to charge ridiculous money, but make it a threshold where there is perceived value there. And you're going to find your fans engage much more tightly with you because of that.
Right. So how can they sign up? What's the process with Crowd Music?
Yeah, it's really easy. It's just crowdmusic.com. Now I know that you have a referral code as well. That you feel free to share with all of your listeners and viewers here. It really comes down to if you're kind enough to tell others about us and bring people to the table, we want you to prosper in that. So each of you who sign up, you will get your own referral code. And at that point, feel free, if you find a song that you love on Crowd Music or you just love the premise of what it's about, share your referral code with other friends, share it on social media. And as you do so, you are building your crowd as well. You are then in the very near future going to be able to monetize that. Go out and find great artists. We're always looking for phenomenal new acts, great songwriters. We're talking with a lot of publishers. We actually have our first major label that is releasing an artist with us. So things are moving quickly. You will be on the front side of this. A year from now, it's going to look a whole lot different and be quite crazy. So now's the time to get aboard.
Now, if they are an artist, can they sign up and get their music on, or how do
they? Here's the other beautiful thing. Unlike Spotify, where 40,000 songs are uploaded daily, on our system, you have to go through kind of a curation process. We want the best of the best. We want great music. We don't want just something that you put together in an hour's time and auto-tuned, you know, underarm sounds and all that stuff. We really want great music so that if people come over and they hate country, they hate rap, they can at least listen and be like, hey, I can understand why this is here. So yes, you can actually send those submissions. I believe, you know, you can send those to info@crowdmusic.com. Actually, what we're preferring to do is go through somebody like Michael or somebody else who is directly aligned with Crowd and that we trust, you know, who is an industry professional who knows what great quality is. Again, we want everybody kind of connecting with one another. Let's make this a great gathering of folks who are like-minded, you know, growing together, prospering together, and it'll be a beautiful thing.
Yeah, community. It all comes down to community, and that's really what it is. Whether you're in the music industry, it is a community. Whether you're in the licensing industry and you're getting your songs out there, it really is about building a community. I think the worst thing you can do is just blindly upload your music anywhere.
That's
right.
You
should have connections with people, and you should focus on working with the companies that allow you to have those connections with people. That's what I teach with the licensing side. I always say if you don't have the, you know, your contacts phone number or email, personal email, in your system that you can contact them directly, then you're with the wrong company. And it's
that's really- right. That's right. You're exactly right. And everybody wants to move up together. You know, publishers want great music. They want great artists in their arsenal, and artists want the opportunity to work with those great companies. It's not, you know, there's not this huge moat around the castle, so to speak. You right. just have to show that you have value in what you do. Once you do, man, the drawbridge is down. You know, it's come and go as you need to, you know, just keep delivering great music.
David, thank you so much.
What a pleasure. Thank you for even allowing me to do this.
Oh, man. So much good information. And I love hearing from other musicians who've been able to build a sustainable career in music.
Yes,
especially
absolutely.
One that's now, you know, 2.5 decades, you know, for you, that just says a lot. And all the people that you've worked with, you know, it's just phenomenal. Crowd Music, I'll have a link below for people to check out Crowd Music, and go to crowdmusic.com, of course. And, you know, if any of your goals over the next year include recording and releasing a new album or generating placements of your songs, you want to build a fan base that'll sustain your career, or really just like David has transitioned into a full-time career being a musician, I have a workshop for you at Real Musicians Don't Starve. You can go to realmusiciansdontstarve.com/workshop. And this workshop focuses entirely on the three keys to your success. And that's what we talked a lot about today. So I really appreciate you hanging out. David, I want to finish off the entire session today with my manifesto. If you're a real musician, the first thing here is that you're a business owner. And as real musicians, our business is music. A business is simply an organization where value is provided in order to make a profit. And unlike starving musicians who operate with a mindset of scarcity and fear, as success-driven musicians, we operate with a mindset of abundance, confidence, and service. We're doers, we're dreamers, we're creators, and we are achievers. We know that our true value is determined by how many people we serve and how well we serve them, because our truth is real musicians don't starve.
We'll that is amazing. Love it.
Thanks, buddy. All right, guys. Enjoy your week, and we will see you soon.